AFTERBUZZ TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment.
Very good,
AFTERBUZZ TV. The AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California. Presented by Maria Menounos and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies. This is AfterBuzz TV's Intelligence After Show.
We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's Intelligence After Show.
Yeah. Hey guys, what's up? Thanks for tuning in. AfterBuzz TV, CBS Intelligence, Episode 3, Season Number 1. Yep. Mei Chen's Return. Ladies and gentlemen, can you guess what happens on today's episode?
Did Amos return?
Amos returned, that is correct. I'm your host, Ryan Hooks. Joining me on the panel today, we have... Tell us who you are.
I'm Yael Tygiel. Hi.
And I'm Lynn Gonsalvez, all day, every day.
All day, every day. And ladies and gentlemen, joining us today on the panel, we have a very, very special guest, Mr. Octavius Johnson.
Hey! Thanks for having me.
Hey, thank you for being here. Ladies and gentlemen, the star of stage and screen, yes. Octavius Johnson, joining us here today.
And bow tie aficionado, I must
bow-tie
say.
Bow tie aficionado. Yes.
He didn't
get the bearded memo.
He did not. Well, he said he had just shaved up.
Well, next time.
Yeah.
Next time.
There's always a next time.
All right.
Right.
Cool. So let's get into this. So episode number 3, Mei Chen Returns. As you can guess, Mei Chen Returns. So in the first part of the episode here, we get a good look at our friend Miss Kate Anderson, played by Annie Wersing, who's trying to sell some undercover information.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And she has this flash drive that she stole because she was an operative with, and she's trying to hook up with MI6.
Yep.
And you know what? You think she's going to succeed?
Well,
I'm going to say no.
Yeah, I'm inclined to agree with you. It's okay. No, it's fine. So in this the character that we get here, Kate Anderson, has stolen some information from the government and is trying to sell it off. First with MI6, and then the guy she's trying to sell it to gets shot, gets killed, and she escapes, and she goes to the Chinese embassy. With the Chinese embassy, that was her initial contact point, as we learn. But before we get into that, I want to talk a little bit more about impressions of this week's episode and also of the show as it continues to progress.
Mm-hmm.
What did you guys think so far?
I think the first few minutes, I was like, who are these people? Did I miss an episode? What is happening here?
Mm-hmm.
But luckily, it was all tied in and very important and useful information. So thanks, Intelligence.
For bringing it back around, yeah, bringing in the plot points.
Connecting everything.
So
I'm still trying to feel my way. I must be honest. Just as far as I wanted to kind of pick up, you know, I think it did make some strides, you know, with, you know, Mei Chen returning, and kind of the dynamic, which of course we'll get into later on, with her, you know, and Gabriel. But I want that moment to where you're like, oh yes, it's about to go down. You know what I'm saying?
There it is.
Yeah. I feel like there's a lot of build up, a lot of laying of foundations, you know, pulling different characters in, but I really am ready and, you know, expecting that to happen.
Yeah.
So, hasn't happened yet.
Yeah, and Octavius, you're appearing on episode 8. Hey.
Yes.
So, can you give us a little insight? Maybe there's something we don't know that you know.
Hey, you're just going to have to keep watching.
I guess I'll have to keep watching.
But what I do enjoy about the show, I'm a sensitive guy, and what I enjoy is like how Gabriel just still yearns for his wife and reminiscing, you know, with his wife. And I just love that. He's just not this highly advanced CIA operative.
He's not just a soldier.
So I always love the, you know, the foundation.
The softer side.
Yeah, the
tender
soft
moment.
Side. Yeah, right. So I enjoy that. Yeah.
You would know something about a wife.
I would.
You would.
Yeah.
I'm married.
Moments.
You just got married.
Yes, I did.
Congratulations.
Yeah, marriage.
Thanks so much. Thank you.
I just wanted to make sure.
It's a great life. It's a great life. It's wonderful.
This good-looking gentleman here is married, ladies.
Off the market, ladies.
Hands off. However, Lem and I are equally single, and we'll be happy to take your numbers. And
I'm extremely single, so, yeah.
We're fine. Yale as well is available.
Thank you. What is that? Thanks.
Oh,
thank
yes.
Oh,
sad song.
There it is.
No worries.
There it is.
So, yeah. So, as I said before in our last episode, and as you're pointing out, I commented that this show needs to do something to set itself apart from other shows that are like it. Because there are a lot of shows in this similar concept right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And one of the things that I said is I would like to see, you know, more of that the soul bearing, that sensitive side, that mm-hmm. that's going to get something that's going to keep viewers interested. It's right. going to draw yeah. people in. Because, right. I mean, it has to be more than CIA missions. It has mm-hmm. to be more than, mm-hmm. you know, Josh Holloway kicking butt, which I do thoroughly enjoy. I do like the fight scenes and the guns and the stabbings and all that. But, you know, I can watch Expendables if that's all I want to see.
Right. Mm-hmm. right. You want to be connected to the character.
Right.
You know, you want to, like you were saying yeah. before, you see that he yearns for his wife. I think that is what is keeping people watching, because they want to see how this plays out. You know, they have a tie to that. Everyone has missed someone or lost someone
yeah.
Or,
yeah.
or some degree of that. So, yeah, you have this side of him kicking butt and doing what he does, yeah. but you have this other side of him yeah. that he continues to display.
And this week yeah. was definitely one of those stronger ones about the mourning of a loss, because everyone right. can relate. To that.
Yeah, almost definitely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
most definitely.
And they do a great job with that. And at what I can say at the end of this episode, Gabriel asked Riley if she would do the same thing, and when she said yes, I would, he was like, he just agreed with. He was like, that's good. So, yeah,
she would tackle him out the window again, yeah. uh-huh. situation yeah. to save his life.
Yeah, yeah. yeah. So, and he agreed and he let it go. So that's kind of cool.
I think we're seeing some relationship yeah. development, which we're going to talk about here in a little bit between Riley and Vaughn. One thing I was going to say to them, but I kind of want to talk about it now because we're right there, is Amelia. You know, it's assumed that she is dead. You, Yael, said last time that you do not think she's dead.
I still hold on to the
several
fact
of our viewers. Said that she isn't dead, and they agree that with that she is coming back at some point. And there's been a lot of buzz on the internet about this character that is a huge part of the show, even three episodes in, and has been written off after two episodes. So, do you guys think we know where she stands? Do you guys think, based on what you've seen in the three episodes, is Amelia coming back?
It's a good question. I still stand by what I said last week, and I don't think she is. I think we'll still see her, because I think that is the element of what keeps him going.
Mm-hmm.
And I think with the way the show is going, I think they're using that as a catalyst to keep him on that softer side. And then I think at mm-hmm. one point in time, again, we're not doing predictions yet, but I think at one point in time, they're going to, you know, take the rug from under him, and then that's when we're going to see something change within him. That's my opinion, you know, but whatever.
Okay, so what do you think?
I agree.
Yeah.
You think we need to get something in there,
yes.
you know, something yeah. that he's going to lean towards and go to, and then all of a sudden it's going to crash and burn.
Yeah, I mean, I think I see something going on with him and Riley.
Says so. The guy in episode 8 who yeah. knows a little bit.
See?
Well, my character is a little fresh, so...
Keeping it secret, yeah, it's okay. Yeah.
Oh, well, he thinks that Riley is eye candy, so...
Wait, are
my
you,
character.
Your so character is going to get with Riley, nothing. Is that
no,
what you're telling
no.
us?
No,
Octavius is married. No, he cannot think that Megan Ori is eye candy. However, I think that Megan Ori is eye candy.
No one's disagreeing.
I second that as well.
No one's disagreeing.
Yeah.
Can I get a third from the booth? Nope.
Yo.
Hanging out with two.
We got it.
That's
no,
all right.
We got it. We got it.
So, yeah, so I agree. I tweeted out an article this week, and I'll send it out again for those of you that missed it. And it was about the writers, and they asked him, you know, why did you write her off so early? And part of it was, we're not saying yes or no that she's dead or not. So they blatantly avoided that question.
Mm-hmm.
Which, you know, it could go either way. And I could see where she could come back. But I also kind of like the idea of her being gone, because that gives us an ability to watch Josh Holloway's character and Gabriel Vaughn grow and develop and become this new person. And so he's saying that, yeah, that, and that part of the reason they wrote her off so early is so they don't have an entire season of him trying to find her.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that now that that has been resolved, if you will, mm-hmm. based on what we've seen, that he can continue and move forward, and he can progress as a person. He can progress in relationships, and also even in his role, you know, in the agency and developing his skills. Because we saw at the end of this episode, he got an upgrade, his new chip, his 2.0 version.
Oh, yeah.
Which we don't know anything about other than what we saw with Mei Chen. You know, he's going to progress, and he's going to probably have some new skills.
Well, according to him, he is the chip. Remember that.
Right.
Yeah,
he is the chip.
I am
yeah,
the chip.
I am mm-hmm. the chip. So
the chip is he, and he is the chip.
Right. All in the same.
And mm-hmm. I shall call him Chip.
Says Steve Jobs. Apple Incorporated. Yeah. No.
We actually commented on the first couple episodes if this could be our version of, you know, Apple taking over the world.
Yeah.
So hopefully it's not.
Well, you know, the little
the eye
contact
chip,
lens.
The contact chip.
Google, right?
The Google Glass.
The Google Glass. Yeah, absolutely. That's
something to see. 2014.
Wow. That's right.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Anyway, let's get back onto the episode here and see what we can figure out with what happened. So, Mei Chen has returned, And she first makes an appearance when Vaughn is doing a cyber rendering. He's trying to figure out, after he's been brought back by Riley from Mexico, what happened to Kate when she escaped and after the shooting. It creates this world where, you know, she's trying to sell the chip, and he feels this presence in the cyber rendering. But he doesn't know what it is, so he follows it up the stairs and chases after it, and he learns that it is Mei Chen. Do you think that this concept, you know, because we talked about singularity last week, you know, the forming of man and machine, that this is crossing a line with that concept? Because now that she's invading his mind, his dreams, his imagination, you know, is that too much to take in as a viewer?
Well, I think Dr. Cassidy pointed out that, like, it's a whole different world, and it's no longer his rendering. Mm-hmm. It's this whole new concept, and I think that it's getting the show past the science fact. It's becoming even more sci-fi, which is great for those of us who love sci-fi.
Yes.
And I'm really very excited to see where it goes.
Wow, yeah. You are straight on point, yeah.
Yes, oh, yeah. Wow. It's totally, yeah. It's because, you know, the show came out as, you know, with first impressions, it's a CIA-based crime drama, you know, where, or, you know, whatever their U.S. agency is. Mm-hmm. And that's the focal point. But now we're crossing into these worlds of, you know, internet and technology. Well, now we're getting even farther into dream world and, you know, concepts of non-realities that are being created and imagined, but they're living in them. I mean, that can be all kinds of sci-fi really fast.
I'm so excited.
Right. And I think, too, that's just, you know, we talked about this last week as far as, like, setting themselves apart from these other shows that are just like them. They're going to have to do something that's going to keep you be like, oh, I've never seen that before. You know, because with so much competition with these other formatted shows that are very, very similar, they have to do something. So a dream sequence with two worlds colliding and all of that stuff, I think that's just customary of what they want to do to keep you, you know, occupied and keep the viewer wanting to keep watching what's going on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. And I think that the way they've done it so far, to me, it doesn't feel hokey. It doesn't feel like they're stretching or they're trying to force something that isn't there.
Mm-hmm.
I don't feel that the sci-fi aspect is, like, over the top at this point.
Yeah.
You know, it's something that I can believe in can happen. I mean, it's
in a sci-fi world. Yes.
I mean, definitely. And obviously in this world that they've created where they've put this chip in his brain, obviously, is a stretch in itself.
Mm-hmm.
But that technology and that concept isn't really something that's that far away from what we have now.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, they're putting it in the future, but it's not that far away in the future where it seems unreachable.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think that that's a good thing because it's giving us something to, like, think about. Wow, that could really happen. That could really, you know, 10 years from now, 5 years from now, that could be people, that could be agents in the field, have this ability to connect to the internet and search things and create these worlds where they're using partial from available data through, you know, television cameras and things on the internet, and also they're creating part of it in their imagination, which you know, a lot of technology is something that somebody imagined at one point.
Right.
So I mean,
I think 10-year-old kids would be the best with these devices in their brains.
Absolutely.
They have the best imagination.
So. Hmm.
Okay, that's off topic.
No, it's great.
That's so on topic.
Dinosaurs in the pool, karate chopping the piranhas. Yeah. I'm in. Let's do it. So yeah, so I think that's a, you know, a good step with what they're doing because it's not that crazy and that far-fetched. Did you feel like, you know what, I don't relate to this?
Mm-hmm. I think they're keeping it as relatable as possible to get people like, hey, you can relate to this. This is relevant. This affects you. But I hope the sci-fi lover in me is like, let's take this crazy places because you've got us. Let's see what we can do with all of this.
I really like too, you know, you have these strong female characters as well. Mm-hmm. And I think that's another thing that's kind of helping the situation because these girls are kicking butt, you know what I'm saying, doing their thing, and you're like, I didn't know that you can do that. You know, I mean, Mei Chen is a beast, you know, and her character is developing more so, and you start to see her and some of the things that happened with this episode where she kind of came face to face and challenged him and basically was like, I'm going to get better than you and trying to school him on his abilities that he can do because, you know, of what they share. So I like that. I do like that. Strong females, I'm all about that.
Yeah.
Power to the women.
Power to the women, says our resident feminist. Mr. Lemon the Beard.
Right.
Maybe that's the feminist seat.
Our feminist beard.
Feminist seat.
Yes,
right,
yes.
Right,
feminist
right.
Seat.
Yael sat there last week, so that was her resident
and
feminist
seat. And was arguing with them about
right,
things.
Exactly.
Because I was talking about guns and explosions and fights and, you know.
And how girls can't.
I don't know. I didn't say they couldn't.
Should I not go
there? Let's go there. No, that can's open. Let's go there.
And women can't do what? What?
I didn't
say.
Women can't do. Women can't do. Never came out of my mouth.
Come on.
It will never come out of my mouth when there's a woman present. or a recording device.
Right.
Of any kind.
Or live streaming.
Yes, or live streaming right. to you folks at home.
Right.
Speaking of live streaming, you guys are watching us at home, tuning in, want to know what you can do to help us out, because we're here helping you out, learning about Intelligence F Show. Check us out on iTunes. You can go on iTunes, you can rate us, you can comment. Tell us what you think about the show, what you think is going to happen, give us some predictions, give us some questions. We'd love to hear back from you. This week we actually have a couple of shout-outs here. Josh Dunham and Trinity Ryder giving us a couple comments on our iTunes feed. Mm-hmm. You go on iTunes, you can check us out. It makes us searchable, makes Intelligence know that we're here, makes the fans be able to find us faster. Five-star ratings, comments, we'd love to hear that. Available on all your devices. You can also check us out on our YouTube and also our AfterBuzz website. So thank you guys for all that, and, you know, tune in, rate us, let us know.
And I would like a special comment for those of you that will comment about my man Octavius' bow tie, because it's really fly.
Oh, man.
Yes, and I want to know what you think of the bow tie.
What do you think about Octavius' bow tie?
Thank you.
That's what I want to see.
Bow ties are cool.
Exactly.
Bow ties are in. Cool. So since we've hit a break, if you will, Octavius, I want to talk about you.
Hey, man.
What's up?
I'm having a great time.
Word. So tell us a little bit about what you got going on. Because, you know, you're joining us here for Intelligence, which is awesome. You know, you got episode 8 coming out here in a couple weeks.
Yeah.
You got Ray Donovan.
Yes, I'm going back to season 2. I'm going back to season 2 of Ray Donovan. I'm so excited. So honored to be going back. It was a great first season. Oh, it's going to get better. It's going to get better, man. I'm so excited. So going back to Ray Donovan. Have a call back tomorrow for a really good movie. It's going to be a good movie, really good movie. So we'll see about that.
Man of many
two
details.
Auditions after that, and right. It's really busy. It's really busy, man. But I'm glad I could be here.
Newly married, we're glad that you could come in and be with us.
6-month-old baby.
Yes.
6-month-old baby.
Yeah, man.
Can you talk a little bit about your Ray Donovan character and maybe how that's a difference from this character, or maybe is there similarities from what
difference.
You're going to be doing with Intelligence?
Well, Marvin Gaye Washington is from Compton.
Okay.
And my character Troy on Intelligence is he's intelligent.
Okay.
So there's a huge difference. Not a thug, my character on Intelligence. Mm-hmm. But they both have swag, I can tell you that. And they like to bling. Both of them they like to bling.
Says the man in the bow tie.
Yeah.
Do they wear bow ties?
No.
Okay.
No.
Okay. Just the swag part.
There's not that much swag on TV yet.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay. We haven't got there yet.
Does Troy, is it?
Troy is Troy. So I can tell you the name. That's fine. Troy, I play Troy. He's like a, he helps with a lot of problems. Oh. Yeah, so he's a really smart kid.
Does he sing at all? Because I know you sing.
No, no. He doesn't. All
right. No, no singing?
No singing.
Are you singing on Intelligence?
No, I'm not singing on Intelligence. No, okay. I sing on Ray Donovan.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
With a name like Marvin Gaye Washington, how do you not sing?
Exactly. That's kind of, exactly.
So got two shows, you know, going out, a lot of auditions. It's pilot season. Anything can happen.
Anything can happen. Well, you know, we look forward to hearing more about that. You guys check out Octavius Johnson on Ray Donovan and also on Intelligence Episode 8, which we'll be covering here, so you can find out more. We'll be happy to shout you out even more then.
And you're going
to
come back,
please
right?
follow me on Twitter. Come on.
Yeah. You're going to come back for your episode, right?
Please have me back.
Okay.
Yeah, no problem. We'll get your Twitter handle here at the end when we give all kinds of detailed information and all that. But let's get back to it. When everyone has their pens ready to write down your information.
Yeah.
Across the screen. So anyway, let's get back to this episode here. So Mei Chen, strong female character, has returned, and she is out to get the information that Kate Anderson has brought to us. We find that Mei Chen is going into this NBC building, getting some information about other people that she can basically copy and who she can pretend to be so she can sneak in. Finds a woman, kills her, takes her information, takes her ID, uses her technology to break into the building, if you will, as we saw. Also, you know, we saw Gabriel do it in episode 1, where he unlocked the door,
right.
because it is electronic. We get in, and also we have the return of Amos. And I've made no secrets of my love of Amos from episode 1. The reason that I love Amos is he was on the Mighty Ducks.
Okay.
In case you missed that rant that I had about the Mighty Ducks.
Okay, I wasn't here.
I'm letting you know right
so
now.
So what happened?
He was very passionate.
That's all.
About
just
it.
Wow. I love the Mighty Ducks.
Wow.
We don't want to relive it.
I saw that movie. Yeah.
Colton Reed from the Mighty Ducks is Amos. So how do you not love that?
Oh, nice.
Yeah, right? That's quacktastic.
That was unnecessary.
Okay, I'm done. No, so we're seeing this development, though, and we're also seeing now some crossing of fields, if you will. We've got D&I Adam Weatherly, who is a character who's come in, and he's also meeting with the CIA and also Mark Huckenberg's character in Lillian Strand. Mm-hmm. So there has been some information that's been crossed over. CIA is looking into Clockwork, mm-hmm. trying to find out more information. They're being watched, essentially.
Well, they find out that as soon as Clockwork started, the CIA made Operation Janna.
Operation Janna, yeah.
Which to basically watch over Gabriel.
The CIA Oversight Committee.
Yeah. So. They were basically like, hey, we don't trust what you're doing. We're just going to sit here and watch it all mm-hmm. the time.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes. And the CIA Director Jeffrey Tadizzo is overseeing everything, spying on Clockwork, played by Lance Reddick.
From Fringe.
And also trying to figure out more about what they're doing. So we don't know how we feel about that. Anybody feel invaded?
Yeah.
I mean, it's again, you're talking about intelligence, CIA. I mean, you're going to have, you know, those things come together. I just want to see, like, where does it, you know, it's kind of gets muddled a little bit, I think, because you have so many things going on electronically, intelligently, that, you know, you don't know who is doing what, you know what I'm saying? I'm sometimes trying to find out, okay, who's the good guy, who's the bad guy, you know, and sometimes there's not any clear definitions, and that's maybe part of the, you know, the sake of the show, wanting them to kind of keep you kind of guessing, you know, not knowing exactly, you know, who you can trust yet, or yeah. whose side you want to be on, so it is interesting, it is interesting.
Well, it's really interesting to find out who does this department report to?
Mm-hmm.
Who are they, like, where
who's their boss, right?
Right.
Because we saw in the first episode she had enough influence to get the president to sign off on sending Riley over to them.
Right.
Exactly.
So, yeah, who's in charge?
And now we find out that there's another group that's just watching over them without them knowing and checking in on them. So I want to see where it all
the
came
from. The hierarchy.
Yeah, it's the like hierarchy.
Well, that's where Troy comes in. And no.
Oh, hey. So excited.
Teaser.
I was so excited.
That's I always right. get you guys off track. It's funny.
Oh, man.
We just want you to talk.
Hey,
we
man.
Just...
There we go.
No, and we see, too, Thomas Arana, who plays D&I, Adam Weatherly. Mm-hmm. You know, he's coming in. He's from Gladiator. Love him from that movie.
Mm-hmm. Favorite movie.
And he's saying that at the end of the episode, he said, I'll handle it. Mm-hmm. You know, and we see that he and Lillian have a good relationship. So we're not sure if the D&I is going to have some influence in later episodes, or if the Clockwork team is essentially... uncontrollable.
Dun dun dun.
Dun dun dun.
Dun dun dun.
Anyway, we keep getting off topic here. We're having all kinds of too much fun in here.
Yeah.
So back to the episode and what happens and what progresses as the characters get involved. So Mei Chen gets a hold of Kate, gets the microchip, which we were talking about earlier, that's on a contact lens, similar to what they see on Google Eye.
Right.
Has all the information, Google Glass, rather, excuse me. Sorry, folks at Google. We're not plugging them. Has all the information.
Don't anger
them. So it doesn't matter anyway.
Basically has all the information about Clockwork, all the information about Vaughn, all the information about the chip and how it works and how they can use it to basically create more people or, you know, how it worked for her. She downloads all the information and blows the computers up. So she basically is the only one that has this information available to her.
And did she do that with her brain?
She did. She
okay.
Yeah, she overloaded the computers with her brain.
Okay, that makes sense. Yeah, I didn't see her shoot it.
Yeah, so apparently that's another skill that she has.
They were hardwired to the internet, so she was able probably to surge the power.
And I know I'm married, but that was hot. You know, I can say that.
Yeah, no, you can say that.
See, there's boundaries, and that's not a boundary. That's... appropriate, okay?
Yes, that was
hot. It was hot with the brain. She just blew it up.
Yeah.
It's gone.
Absolutely.
Don't worry, we all agreed that was hot.
Yeah. So she blows up the computer and escapes, but we find that then Riley is interrogating Amos and trying to find out where they can find Mei Chen. But they come up with this idea to say, you know, hey, can we find her the way that we've been able to find her previously in these cyber renderings?
Mm-hmm.
Because she appeared to Gabriel in the first cyber rendering when he was trying to analyze the crime scene. She appeared to him in a second cyber rendering when they were traveling to the Chinese embassy, where basically, sees him, talks to him, threatens him. He pulls out his gun.
Almost shoots Riley.
Almost shoots Riley, but Riley cold cocks him and knocks him out of cyber rendering.
That was hot, too.
Yeah, that was the part you wanted to talk about.
Yeah, that was hot, too.
Okay, so women throwing down is the thing to do.
Woman power.
Power to women.
Yeah.
Yes,
strong
absolutely.
Female characters.
Right. This is the feminist role right here.
Yeah, West Side.
West Side.
Women.
West Side. Yeah, the women big side. W.
Yeah.
What if I turn upside down?
Stop it.
Men? Okay.
I'm done. I'm going to stop. Back on task.
I just all ended right. that conversation.
And done. Abrupt ending. So, yeah, so we see that our powered women are basically involving themselves more and more as those episodes progress. But Mei Chen is in these cyber renderings, and they said, you know what, we can maybe get her. That can be our in, because the last couple times that they've had these cyber renderings, that's where she's appeared to him, and that's where they've been able to have her around the longest, have her unprotected, right. That sort of thing. So Dr. Cassidy and Nelson come up with this idea where they can basically hack her brain through Vaughn's cyber rendering. And when they go in, they bring her in, they say, okay, we just need to keep her there, and they're watching on the computer, and they're seeing all this interaction, and he's like, man, I wish I could be there.
Yeah.
You know, I love Dr. Cassidy coming in mm-hmm. and all his things that he does. But basically, they are successful and able to hack the computer process and erase the file. So after the file is erased, there's a scene where the cyber rendering is sort of dissolving, if you will, and Mei Chen disappears. Do you think that at that point that this is the end of Mei Chen, or is this the end of just the Clockwork file and she will return?
I think neither of those things. I think that, one, there's no way Mei Chen has disappeared now. There's no way. She's such a great character and mm-hmm. such a great villain, I guess, mm-hmm. Because there's so much that we don't know about her and we need to understand about her. So there's no way she's gone. And I think also that they got rid of the file, but I don't know if you know how to use a computer. You can put your file in the trash. That doesn't mean it's gone.
Yeah.
But if they bugged her, what do you guys think? Because I said she disappeared. It showed on the screen, Clockwork JPEG deleted.
Sure. JPEG?
Whatever. I'm going to have PDF. I'm going to have to agree with my girl, Yael.
Yep.
Just because, first of all, the name of the episode is Mei Chen Returns.
Mm-hmm.
So I can't see the next episode being Mei Chen is gone forever.
Yeah.
Like, I'm just saying. So I think that she's definitely coming back. And I agree. I don't think that that's the end of that, because I think there's so much that has to be, you know, as far as the content of what this show is about. So
yeah.
I can't see that happening where it's, you know, completely, unless they're filling it with something else that's grandiose. And again, that could happen. But I'm really leaning on the side of what Yael said, as far as, like, I think that's still there,
mm-hmm.
and I think it's gonna come back abruptly some other way. They're gonna be in, you know, maybe Mars or something, and then all of a sudden, you know, they're gonna appear just like when they were in Mexico,
yeah.
And then the show is gonna start, and you're gonna be like, how did that happen? You know,
well, Pluto.
Just saying, it's sci-fi.
Yeah.
Well, Pluto's not a planet anymore, Octavius. So.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'm late.
You are late.
You're a little behind. No, but do you think she's gone, or do you think she's coming back?
No, it's too early. She's just getting started.
Right.
So I'm not saying that I disagree with all of you. However, to play devil's advocate,
you disagree with all of us.
No, I mean, with the concept of you can't just write her off. Well, yeah, as of right now, they just wrote off Amelia. You know, I'm not saying she's not coming back, but I'm just saying that as of now, she's gone.
Okay. And, as of now.
And she's way, I think, to me, way more important to the show, and to the plot, and to the characters than Mei Chen could have ever been.
Amelia?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But can you say that? Because we still haven't really seen Mei Chen in her glory yet.
And we're only
Mei Chen didn't blow up.
Exactly.
I mean, they showed Mei Chen disappearing, and
yeah,
if you will, but they did not show Amelia blowing up.
No, but
they showed an explosion.
She did. Yeah, where'd she go? Did she jump out of the building?
Anyone who has seen any soap opera mm-hmm. knows that unless you see a body,
oh cool,
the person, and even then,
not
right,
even then.
Right, I was gonna say
even they then. Can come back.
I've seen Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. He's been dead and he's back anyway.
Right,
I love that.
With spoiler alert.
Oh, spoiler alert, don't watch Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and find out. No, I mean, if you watch Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. episode one, they talk about the Avengers and how he's back to life.
Right.
I'm
not spoiling anything, thank you. Wow. So, no, and I'm just asking them, stirring the pot, if you will. But I agree, I don't think that Mei Chen is gone. I think that she's, in an aspect, going to be our arch-villain.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, in episode one and two, we need something that is going to challenge Vaughn. Because as of right now, until we saw Mei Chen, there has been nothing that could stop him in any episode that seems, you know, like a challenge.
Right.
So this is something that will be a challenge, because she has the same technology and advancements that he has. And, I mean, really, from what we've seen of her, she is as skilled, if not more, mm-hmm. of a combat person, of mm-hmm. a fighter,
yeah.
You know, as an operative.
Well,
so
that's the thing, is that we don't know where she came from. They just brought in a woman and said, this is a woman who has the same genetic mutation. Yep. We're going to put the chip in her. And today, or in this episode, they said that, you know, like, clearly She isn't just some girl that they picked up who has the mutation. She has to have some skills.
Right.
So I think that she's going to come back, and I really hope that at least at one point they work together on something.
Equally appealing as Josh Holloway? Come on now.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, so it works out.
You got to have a strong woman to have a strong man, right? Absolutely. So, yeah, and so, like I said, I think she'll be back. I think she'll be an arch nemesis. But at the same point, to argue against you again, because I just like to argue, we don't know much about Vaughn either. I mean, they've commented, that he was Special Forces.
He was in Iraq and Afghanistan.
And they've commented on that, and you like it when he's shirtless.
Yeah, I do.
We've commented on that. But we don't know much more about him, about his history, what made them put the chip in his brain, you know, what is his driving motive and force behind the reason that he's doing this.
Oh, and that he has to...
The genetic mutation.
Yeah, another thing has a mutation.
Yeah, no, I agree.
Well, again, you know, as we said before, it is three episodes.
Yep.
So, you know, I think they are trying to lay the foundation. I'm giving the show credit with doing that.
Yeah,
you know, my man hasn't even come on. He's in episode 8, and it's going to be amazing. So, you know, it could be in episode 8. You know what I'm saying? You never know. We're episode 3.
And he won't tell us. Thanks a lot.
What are you talking about? He told us everything. He's playing a character named Troy.
He's smarter than I am.
Troy's intelligent and doesn't sing. What more do you need?
Exactly.
That's I'm not it. A smart guy. Just play one on TV.
Yeah.
I play one on the radio, guys. Thanks for tuning in.
Yeah. So I really think that they're just laying the foundation, and these things will kind of peel away, and we'll start to see other things and more character development on all these people. And I think whoever's been written off is still going to be around.
Yeah.
Wow. That's
I expected Amos to be gone,
and there he was. There it is.
I was so excited.
And that's your boy.
Amos isn't boy. I'm glad he's back.
That's what I'm saying.
So in terms of progression and development, then, what do you think with the development of this new chip, this 2.0 version, if you will, of the brain chip that, you know, she talks about when she's in the third rendering, all the things that she's discovered that he can't do? Because she's able to hack his brain, but he can't hack hers.
Right.
She's able to, you know, download these large files of information. She's able to experience things. She actually wants to create an army of other people like them, so that they're not alone. Because she says they're not special; they're alone.
Mm-hmm.
So, do you think that this new 2.0 chip is going to have a bunch of cool new things that we're going to experience as well?
Well, I think
that goes back to Mei Chen not being gone, you know, forever, because she's just so more advanced than Gabriel is to me right now, you know.
But even without the chip, she's more advanced than Gabriel, because she's saying, like, you didn't even think to try these things.
Mm.
Yeah. She's a smarter.
Yeah.
Yep.
Wow.
I really don't think... I think it's going to be somewhat to do with the chip. I think... But I don't think that the chip, I think, is just a catalyst for something else. Like, I don't think the chip is like, okay, now with this better chip, so now there's going to be more stuff going on as a result of this chip. I think that's just something else to put in the pot. You know, I think it's going to be more about Mei Chen against Gabriel and kind of how that, you know, kind of comes together. And I do think that they are going to come together and do something together for a common purpose.
Ooh.
I'm kind of jumping ahead on bridges.
That's a desire.
Mark that right now, folks.
Yeah.
We've got two super chip powers teaming up to form one mighty power.
Just saying, man.
Optimus Prime in the house.
It just looks like it's moving in that direction. But I think the chip is kind of just more of a relic feature. It's more about, you know, them coming together and kind of seeing where that goes.
She did say that he was Adam, she was Eve.
Mm-hmm.
Gabriel disagreed.
Said she was the serpent.
But it's only episode 3.
Episode 3.
Oh, nice.
So, speaking of the chip as a way to bring two people together, like you said, they did comment on wanting to create this new superpower, this new race of people, if you will.
Oh, yes.
And so we saw them together, and we've seen Gabriel in a couple of things here. So, first, he's with Amelia.
His wife, girlfriend.
His girlfriend, yeah. Wife, whatever, who's been undercover, deep cover for these years. She's gone. Then we see Mei Chen trying to move in, if you will, because she's definitely hitting on him.
Oh, yeah.
She was not subtle.
She was not subtle at all. But, you know, sometimes men need that. Women, do not be afraid to be direct.
Don't. How do you...
PSA.
She came after me, man. I don't tell people that, but...
Octavius Johnson taken off the market.
An exception.
Yeah.
It's okay.
You just told the world.
Listen, Octavius Johnson was pulled off the market by an aggressive woman. And since we're all about women's empowerment, it's 2014, you can buy me dinner, you can ask me out. Follow me on Twitter. For great things to come.
No,
I'm using this as a lead-in, trust me. This is going somewhere.
I hope so.
Because what we're starting to see now as well is this development of a relationship, in my opinion, between Riley and Vaughn.
Yeah. Beginning.
Did you not see
the first two episodes?
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. They haven't done anything other than made a couple of phone calls, and they went to Mexico together.
Not really.
Indirectly. So, but we're starting to see some kind of development, and you commented that the thing you liked at the end of the episode was he asked her, would you do it again?
Mm-hmm.
If you were given the opportunity to reenact the situation that happened, would you do it?
Save my life, kill my wife. Wow. Sorry.
That's exactly it. That's exactly what happened.
Yeah.
And he says, you know, would you do it? And she says, yes, I would do it. You know, they had this moment at the end, but they, throughout the episode, have little moments.
I think they do.
You know, when they're in the car outside of the Chinese embassy, after they found out that Mei Chen has escaped with Kate, you know, and Lillian's telling her that you need to come in, we're going to put you in a box, essentially. They're going to decommission him and make it so that he's not operable. He says, no, you can't decommission me. I'm the chip. The chip is me. And I'm going to do this whether you want it or not. And he says, hey, are you with me? She's with him.
Exactly.
So she's bought into what he's selling, whether it's being shirtless or not.
Yeah.
It's being shirtless. It is.
She also likes him as a person.
Right.
She also cares about his opinions and his emotions.
Right.
Probably not. No, but like I said, we're starting to see this as a development of a relationship. So, and I think this goes back and ties back into the Amelia thing. And you were saying you could see something down the road. Do you potentially see that he will create some kind of relationship with Riley in future episodes, and then Amelia could return, or that could be our huge rock and hard spot, bump in the road, soap opera drama?
Wow.
Definitely. I think that their relationship is going to get, as he continues to mourn and is vulnerable, they're going to get even closer.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully something will, I mean, something might possibly happen, hopefully.
You want it to happen.
I definitely do. I think it would be beautiful.
Okay.
Wow, that's just evil.
Why is that evil?
Come on. You have to let Gabriel and Riley just make it happen.
No, I'm not that's forcing what she wants. It.
You know, and let it organically just... be true.
Is that what's going to happen, Octavius?
I don't know, but...
Oh, okay, I'll just...
So by episode...
I know everything.
Just dangling right in front of us.
You see how he does that?
It's funny, I can't say much, and that's why it's so hard to talk sometimes.
But you say so much.
I know this, but...
Yeah.
Can't say that, so... But after episodes air, I can talk all about it.
Great. Well, feel free to call back in on episode 8, and we will be here in the studio discussing it and you in depth.
Yeah.
What do you think, Lem? Do you think that this could be something we see down the road as a bump in the road?
I'm going to say yes, just because there's a lot of momentous moments. You know, my boy Octavius was talking about how he yearns for his wife. So I think it definitely can go in that direction.
Right.
The show has kind of laid the foundation for that. There's a lot of that going on. So, yeah, I mean, there's nothing to expound on it. It's just,
Yeah. I'm sorry, I cut you off. What were you saying, though?
I definitely lost my
and
train of thought.
And then I said that was evil. But
right. I just started picturing them. So I lost my train of thought. Oh.
She was having a nice, lovely thought of them together in Mexico on a beach.
And then
him shirtless, of course.
I'm not going to deny it.
Her in her red cape.
What?
Riley or yeah?
No, yeah,
me?
That's cool.
Riley.
Me and my wife, Riley and Gabriel.
Got it.
Okay. No.
And the bow tie.
I'm sorry, I was making a joke. Riley, Megan Olry, plays Little Red Riding Hood on the show Once Upon a Time.
Okay, gotcha.
So I made the comment about her and a red cape.
It was good. I got it.
Yeah.
I liked
One of us picked it up. One of us didn't. For those of you who don't know, Megan Olry plays Little Red Riding Hood in Once Upon a Time.
Okay.
Cool.
I had said last time about the relationship that I think that no matter what, undoubtedly, they will eventually, something will happen. There's no way to fight it.
It's inevitable.
It's inevitable.
Okay.
I mean, they're together all the time.
Right.
How do you not?
Right. It's a like I said, it's a Brennan and Booth situation, a Castle and Beckett situation. It's going to happen.
Yeah.
Unless it turns into a Stabler and Benson situation, which would ruin my life.
Could you elaborate more, please?
Yeah.
For those of us who don't watch those shows.
Brennan and Booth is Bones.
Okay.
They ended up getting married and having a baby, I believe.
Yeah.
Castle and Beckett are Castle.
Got that one.
Nice. Oh, and the last one, sorry, that was Law and Order SVU. where they're cops and they're partners and they're like brother and sister, which ruined everything.
But you know, you figure these cop shows, they're together all the time. She's basically calling him twice a day, protecting him.
Yeah.
They are getting to the point where, you know, something's gonna happen. So, so which brings me into my most favorite part of the episode and of the show, AfterBuzz TV Intelligence Prediction.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Do I get soundboard hung?
Oh, man, no sound effect.
Now you're AfterBuzz TV Prediction.
There it is. Stephen Lemieux, ladies and gentlemen, in the booth, flashing lights and giving us the voiceover.
Yes.
I want to know what you guys are going to think is going to happen. Octavius, would you lead us into some predictions of next week's episode based on what you've seen thus far, not giving us too much information?
Okay.
Which is what he's all been doing.
Feel free to just make stuff up if you can't tell us anything.
I think so. Yeah, so that relationship between Gabriel and Riley continuing to develop, possibly. Maybe Nelson and his dad, the doctor, say get into a big argument. Who knows? Ooh. You know?
Hey,
and that causes a
turmoil
within the CIA, the cyber command. So those are two. Maybe Mei Chen falls in love with Gabriel.
All
as
right.
Well,
we've got a lot of good predictions. Did you guys watch the trailer at the end of the episode?
No.
Did you see what happens in the next week's episode?
No.
Okay. By the looks of it, in the trailer, it looks like they're showing some information about Vaughn, and it looks very military, very. I almost want to say flashback, if you will. Okay. So to me, my prediction is I'm looking for more backstory on Vaughn, which is why I didn't bring it up earlier. I was like, I gotta wait till the end.
Right.
I think that we're gonna get a little bit more about his connection to the agency, his backstory with the SEALs or whatever team he was on, and you know, why he's doing what he's doing. Because obviously going into this is a big undertaking, and it's something that not everyone's capable of doing.
Yeah.
So, cool. What do you guys think?
I think that as anyone who's ever worked for a startup with computers, you know that there are always bugs when you release a new version. So I think that we're going to have some crazy awesome bugs with this chip next week specifically.
Awesome.
I think that's how it's going to go.
Hmm. Well, I've kind of given like my predictions throughout the whole show. But I will say that I'll just sum it up by saying I think that there's going to be probably what you've been waiting for. There's going to be some connections made between, you know, our boy Gabriel and at least one of his female counterparts.
Yeah.
All right.
At least one.
Nice.
Lots of good things. We got some flashbacks, got some love. Mm-hmm. Everything we need to make a great episode of Intelligence Episode 4. So tune in next week where you can find us here. Tell us where you can find them.
You can find me on the web at yael.tv. That's yael.tv. And on Twitter at Yael Tygiel, yaeltygiel. I apologize for all the letters.
Hey, it's all right. Let them tell us where we can find you.
You can find me on Instagram and on Twitter, the Poet Saint all day, every day. That's the Poet Saint all day, every day, because I do poems about intelligence. Yeah.
You can find me on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, Octavius J. Johnson, OctaviusJ. And we hope you enjoyed the show. Thanks for having me.
Hey, thanks for tuning in. And as always, you can find me at RyanHooks92 at Twitter, Yahoo, Instagram, and Facebook. Hit us up. Let us know what you think. Comments on next week's episode. Thanks again to our special guest, Octavius Johnson,
Octavius
for being here.
And his bow tie.
And for tuning in to the Intelligence After Show. We'll see you guys next week. Have a great
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.
Thank you for watching AfterBuzz TV on YouTube. For more of your favorite after shows and interviews, subscribe to our channel here, and be sure to share your opinion on the episode in the comment section below here. We'd love to see what you guys are buzzing about. Thanks again. Buzz you later.